Good evening. My name's Brett Howe. I'm the executive producer here at QPAC. Firstly, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of this place and pay respect to the elders past and present. On behalf of the Queensland Performing Arts Centre and Tourism Events Queensland, I'd like to welcome you to this, the third conversation, the series of conversations for Clancestry. This one's called Kinship and Identity. Clancestry is a new initiative and it celebrates the arts and cultures of the world's First Nations people, and especially this one celebrates the cultures of the people of this place. We started Clancestry two nights ago with our first conversation, and we're heading into a full weekend of free activities in the cultural forecourt and at the other end of QPAC in the Cascade Court in the Melbourne Street Green. And I'd invite you all to come and participate in that wonderful activity that we've got. I'll also mention we've got a very special performance in the concert hall on Saturday night, Dirt Song by Black Arm Band. And this is a wonderful concert featuring some of Australia's premier artists, and I've got to read them because I'll forget them. Archie Roach, Lou Bennett, William Barton, special guests Jimmy Barnes and Paul Dempsey. So it's going to be a fantastic concert. So I'll encourage you all to grab a ticket from QPAC.com, marketing, I've done it, or grab a brochure on the way out. There'll be some brochures on the way out. You can see all of the activities over the weekend and where you can get tickets for that concert. All right, that's my plug done. Now I've got some housekeeping. So I need to let you know that tonight's conversation is being recorded up the back for possible webcast or broadcast or some kind of cast, probably not an arm cast. It's important that we share these stories further than just the people in this room, so we want to share those stories. What I need to tell you, though, is if you join in the conversation, if you ask a question, if you make a statement, you're in effect giving your permission for us to broadcast that. So to make that happen, you have to do the talking into one of these microphones, and they'll be floating around with our front of house staff. So can you make sure you talk into a microphone if it's your turn to speak. So that's the housekeeping done, and it's my pleasure now to introduce the chair of this session, Rhoda Roberts. Rhoda's the guest curator of Clancestry, but that's the latest in a long list of accomplishments that Rhoda has developed over her very short life. And I would take ages to talk about all of those accomplishments, and in fact we did that last night at our last conversation, so rather than tell you what Rhoda's done, I'd encourage you to go to the QPAC website and check it out for yourself, because that conversation will be up for people to view in the next couple of days. So I'll simply say that she's a wonder and a treasure, and I'm sure that she'll guide us through tonight's conversation with effortless ease. Over to you, Rhoda.
Thank you very much, Brett. Good evening, everyone. And it's wonderful to be here on the ancient lands of our custodians of the Brisbane region. I welcome you all. We're going to have a great discussion this afternoon. But, Brett, I'm wondering about the short life. Do you know something I don't? Whatever you do, don't smoke. Okay. So we're going to have a great discussion. This is something that, for Clancestry, is wonderful to have a platform where we're able to discuss some of the many issues we as Aboriginal people discuss in our own communities, but we often don't get the platform to hear the varying opinions of issues that affect us on a daily basis. So we will allow some time later in the evening for questions, but first I'd like to welcome our panel, and I'll introduce from my right, of course, we'll go to the male, the only male on our panel, but he makes up for many men. So Mr. Kevin O'Brien, he's an architect. You're only born in 1972. True. Oh, you're a baby, darling. That was my first year of high school. Anyway, he finally, when he grew up, graduated from the University of Queensland in 95, has a Bachelor of Architecture, and in 2006, he graduated with a Master's of Philosophy. In 2007, Kevin established Kevin O'Brien Architects in Brisbane, and between 2009 to 2011, he designed and built the Archibald Street House with Susan Ellison. The house was built around the Indigenous and European traditions of its inhabitants. Really interesting. And in 2013, he was appointed Professor of Design, School of Design, Creative Faculty, the Queensland University. Fantastic. Amazing. Beside Kevin is a wonderful Mulinjali woman, Dr. Chelsea Bond, who's currently employed as a senior lecturer with the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Studies Unit at the University of Queensland. Chelsea has worked as an Aboriginal health worker and researcher in urban and rural communities for many, 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 many years. She's also a mother. But as an Aboriginal woman, Chelsea has a strong and personal and professional interest in Aboriginal identity. In fact, her PhD research critically examined the construction of Aboriginality within the public health practice. On my left, the gorgeous Dr. Anita Heiss. Now we know her. I'm sure many of you know her. She's an author of fiction, non-fiction, historical fiction, and commercial women's fiction, also a bit of poetry, social commentary, and travel articles. That's a bit of a junket, isn't it?
A little bit.
Gosh, can I do some of those travel ones
sure.
with you? Yeah. But she's also the author of some best-selling novels, Not Meeting Mr. Right and Avoiding Mr. Right. Are you still single? Did you?
Well, tonight
you got a bloke, didn't
I
you?
Am. Might not be tomorrow.
She might not be tomorrow. There's drinks in the foyer afterwards. And Anita has won 4 Deadly Awards for Outstanding Achievement in Literature. And her most recent book is... This is the big plug.
Oh.
Can you do it? Am I Black Enough for You? So that's Miss Anita Heiss. Oh, Dr. Anita Heiss, I should say. And beside Anita, probably our youngest member of the panel, Megan Cope. And Megan works in the visual arts practice, investigates issues relating to identity, the environment, and mapping practices. She's from the Quandamooka region. And through her art, she explores decolonising mythologies, which have become a primary concern in many of her video works along with her paintings. So welcome, panel. Let's get stuck into it. I'm going to start with Anita first. And Anita, what I'd like to ask you is, you know, often when you meet a black fella, it's like, oh, g'day sis, how you going, brother? Who's your mob, right? But we talk about country, and country defines many, many things, as does community. What's your country?
My country is Wiradjuri country, central New South Wales. My mobs, we often talk about country, but we talk about also in modern sense, so what the mission from where you're from and the Anglo or the name. So I'm a Williams from Arambi and from Brungle Mission, and Griffith, Cowra, Tumut, Wiradjuri country, central New South Wales, one of the largest nations in New South Wales. And, you know, we're talking about Mudgee, Bathurst, Dubbo, Condo and places like that. But I was born in Gadigal country, and most of you all know that as the city of Sydney. And I've spent most of my life growing up on Darawal land, which is La Perouse, strategically placed between Long Bay Jail, Malabar Sewerage Works and Orica Industrial Estate. And so I feel like I have a connection to those three places because I have a birthright, I guess, in Sydney, in Gadigal country, and I consider myself a manager of country because I'm not from there, but I have a responsibility to care for country. And I would say I feel like I'm a part of those three communities because, you know, one of the things when we talk about who's your mob, where you're from, it's about what community do you belong to. And I think lots of people often think also that community is about only Aboriginal people have a sense of community. But I'm also a member of a writer's community and a black women writer's community. So having said all that, I'm really excited to be here in Murray country and on the traditional lands of the local mobs on both sides of the river. And because I've spent a lot of time here, so I feel like I'm part of a community here as well.
Well, Chelsea, you, of course, living in Inala. Tell us about Mulinjali land and what country means to you.
Okay, so I in terms of my identity, I have to declare that Bond is my married name. And that indicates my husband's mob. I'm originally a Wadigo, and that acknowledges my South Sea Islander ancestry as well. I'm Mulinjali through my nana, who was through the Williams family at Beaudesert. But I was born and raised in Brisbane and lived most of my life in Yuggera country. My husband's an Inala boy, and he took me there many years ago, And it's the place that we decided to raise our family because it provided a sense of cultural safety and security in identity that other suburbs couldn't offer us in Brisbane. And so for us, there's a strong sense of attachment and identity with a community like Inala.
And of course, in Inala, it is a very large Aboriginal community, as we know. But it has, I guess, some of that cultural obligation you have to community. You've really taken that to heart, particularly with some of the volunteering work you're actually doing in that community, which perhaps if you were living back on a mission day, you would have been doing that on country.
I think community involvement, community participation is at the core of our identity. And it really contrasts with public discourses around Aboriginal people and communities as being passive and welfare dependent. For many of us, our sense of identity is bound up in our involvement in our community, in our activism. So it's not a choice, it's what we just do and what we have to do. And I've done research with communities where I ask aunties if they volunteer. Black fellas don't volunteer. We don't talk about it like that, it's just what we do. So that sense of activism and involvement is part of how I see my identity.
And for you, Kevin, of course, your heritage back in the Torres Straits, how do you regard what country you come from and your community?
Yeah, it's a tricky question, but I guess because of Mum's family from the mission there on Hammond Island, that's the place I never grew up, but I always call home. And through Mum's family, people, the Kurrig people there and the Miriam people, through my grandmother out in the east. And I get up there every year to see family and do all that sort of stuff. So what I've been trying to do, I guess, with this new role with QUT is take students of architecture and landscape architecture to this place to understand country as not as this cultural thing, but as the origin of how you might define space, which is what we have to do as architects, articulate space. So country for me is it's a part of a bigger idea that I've called Finding Country, and it's a thing I'll talk about later that I took to Venice, and it generates all the sort of central ideas of how we approach architecture, or should, in this country.
And our youngest member of the panel, Megan, I keep saying that, don't I? Bless her. So you're much more local, of course, Stradbroke Island we've all heard about, and there's been quite a lot of historical events occurring in Straddy, but indeed with the native title more recently. So what would you regard as your country?
So I grew up, I didn't grow up on country, I grew up in Tasmania. My father moved away from Queensland in the 80s during the Bjelke-Petersen regime because it just wasn't a very healthy place to be in the 80s. So we grew up down there, but always had a very, he always told me about Stradbroke Island, and I used to go for holidays, to my nana's, and we'd go swimming all the time, and I felt like that place knew who I was, even though I didn't know that place very well. And I've met, when I came back to Queensland in my late teens, everybody knew who I was and where I was from and my country. So I've always, fortunately, I've been very fortunate to have that connection to my country. We're very lucky on Stradbroke Island that we have made history in the way that we've, we got our native title determinations a couple of years ago, which is like the first in a metropolitan area. It was a big, long fight, but it's a real achievement, and
And of course, your dad left Queensland, left Joe, went to Tasmania and decided to hang around with Jimmy Everett and Michael Mansell.
So you
sort of grew up in a bit of hearing a lot of other things. And
yes.
I just want to, just because you've mentioned Tasmania, a number of years ago, of course, there was the big issue in Tasmania where more and more people were discovering that they have had in their family histories some Aboriginal identity as such. And so I think it was 94, correct me, I could be wrong, but the Tasmanian Aboriginal Centre were finding it quite difficult because as one of the smaller groups of Aboriginal people in Australia, they only were getting so much funding for various housing services, et cetera, et cetera. And so they established a thing where if you were Aboriginal, you had to go by a certain date in 94 to the Tasmanian Aboriginal Centre and sign for your family being Aboriginal. And if you didn't do it then, their question to you was, well, why are you coming now? Because you didn't register your family in 94. And it's quite interesting how other communities are now looking at that particular model. But just to get onto that, the three-point plan, there's a Commonwealth definition. You are to be Aboriginal. You're a descent, Aboriginal descent or Torres Strait Islander. You identify as an Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander and your community recognises you. Does that fit into your lives with that sort of identity? Don't be frightened to jump in. Do you like the three-point plan?
I'm troubled by the fact that our conversations focus on Aboriginality as a piece of paper, and it stops us from talking about identity as lived. And I think there's a fair degree of suspicion in the mainstream community about why would you claim an Aboriginal identity? Because for many non-Indigenous Australians, there couldn't possibly be of anything of value to it except for some financial gain. So there's this real suspicion of Indigenous people. For those of us who identify, we know that there's tremendous value in claiming our identity that has nothing to do with a low interest loan on a house. It is our sense of humour, it's our sense of connectedness, it's about belonging, it's about how we give meaning to our world, it's about our sense of family. There's a whole lot of other stuff that our identity means, and sometimes by focusing on this part of the conversation, we forget to talk about identity as lived every day in this country.
I think there's different sides that I think, I mean, I don't sit around with my family and friends and talk about identity. You know, I have these conversations when I get invited to go to festivals or on television or whatever to have the conversation. We don't sit around talking about how to define what it means to be black. No. You know, we do all the bitchy stuff like everybody else does, or, you know, whatever. But, so that's one thing. I think the conversation is in the public domain now because non-Indigenous people have made it a public issue. So I'm really pleased that we're actually controlling this conversation instead of actually reacting to what goes on. And having had to do that for the last few years, you know, I can talk at nauseam about that. The other thing is a lot of our mob don't recognise that the form exists. In recent times, we need to have those sort of safeguards because non-Indigenous people have ripped off the programs that have been set up to help redress the imbalance that exists for our mob across every part of society. So, for instance, you know, I publish books. I was already published with Magabala Books at the time that Leon Carman was a white male taxi driver who'd never met an Aboriginal woman before, imposted himself as Wanda Kilmartry and wrote a book, won prizes and so forth.
Yes.
Now, I understand that organisations need to have in place mechanisms. We're punished by it. We're punished. It is a dog tag sort of thing, but we are now punished because of the behaviour, the bad behaviour of non-Indigenous people. And I do want to safeguard programs and strategies that are being developed so that our people have access and equity in terms of education and employment and housing and health and so forth.
I might mention that because one of the things, you know, whether you go for a housing loan, but indeed with arts, if you go for some arts funding, of course, you often with some processes, you have to provide a confirmation of Aboriginality, which means you go to the local land council of the country you're from, they sign to say, yes, you are a member of this community and you have your confirmation. And there's been quite a lot of discussion, particularly across the arts sector, about this. And at times, and I, again, do understand the process, but at times it's been quite ludicrous, you know, getting turned down or question because you're doing a project with someone like Jakapora Manyaran from Northeast Arnhem Land, who clearly is Aboriginal, but hasn't got a confirmation of Aboriginality. Now, Megan, you faced an issue with this.
Well, recently, I mean, I've always just been Aboriginal and I've always made art, but, you know, I'm thinking I've got bigger ideas now and so, you know, you need a bit more money. So recently I decided to apply for a grant for the first time and I thought, OK, I'm going to apply through the Australia Council, through the Indigenous funding body, not just because it's there, but because the work that I make is about our issues. And so I like to think that I'm adding to this discourse, and so that, you know, this discourse should be funded through that stream as well, you know, because, I don't know, it just made sense. So I get through the paperwork and filling out the form, and I thought, oh, I've got to get my certificate of Aboriginality. Oh, okay, no worries. I ring up Minjirabum Morgan Elders, and I speak to my auntie there, and she said, oh, yeah, no worries, bub, we'll email it through. And I said, oh, yeah, what I've got to do? Oh, you've got to go to a JP, and then you send it back, and then we'll go through a meeting. And I was like, oh, cool, okay, no worries. And then before I hung up, I was like, oh, do you reckon I'll get it? And, like, and she laughed and said, yeah, bub, like, don't be silly. We all know who you are. But I thought that was, like, once we hung up, I kind of, like, thought about what the hell just happened. Mm-hmm. And, like, I actually had an overwhelming sense of self-doubt for the first time. Like, I'm 30 years old. I've always been this way. But going through that system really kind of, I don't know, like, I can't believe that sort of happened. I thought it was really strange.
Can I just say on top of that, because I've sat on boards of community organisations where we have the process where people, and nobody, I speak for myself, but I'm fairly sure that nobody goes through that as part of that signing and the organisational seal. When we think about it, feels comfortable doing that. But we understand it's something that collectively, look, there were 63 different pieces of legislation in history defining who we are. This one was adopted in, was it 84 or 94 or something like that? So this is something that we have collectively as a community, whatever, picked up and run with. Nobody feels comfortable doing that. I hate it when I don't sign off anything that if I don't know the person, I just say, look, I don't know that family. I don't know them. I can't be part of that process. And I think organisations, land councils, community orgs, whoever, who are conscious of what they're doing, and most are, do take it very, very seriously. Because
well, it's actually fraudulent. Yeah. If you feel you've got some Aboriginal heritage but you don't come from a community or you haven't identified as Aboriginal and you sign a paper to get a grant, and then, we find out you're not Aboriginal, it's actually a criminal offence. So I think a lot of people put this in process to protect not only themselves, but their organisations as well.
I mean, I'm the last person that wants to be the identity police. Yeah. And so it's quite difficult when people are put in that situation. But I can see both sides of it. And I'm just saying that it's not easy for the other people either. You know, that have to make the decision. And most of us are lucky that we know. I can go back to Cowra or Wagga or wherever and it's all okay. But for some people who don't know their family and can't go to their local land council, it's problematic. It is problematic.
That's a big issue in the arts. But for you, Kevin, there's quite a few Aboriginal architects now. Do you have faced those issues when you're working on buildings or going into communities?
I do, yeah. We just hit the magic number of 10 graduates in the country.
Wow.
There was,
fantastic.
Yeah, that's. I think it was last year. When I graduated in 95, there was over 100 Maori architects in New Zealand. So Australia's sort of dragging well behind. And we've only had the one professorial position who's come from our background in any of the architecture schools in the country. So that's a pretty poor state of affairs, I think, because there's some great architects who also happen to be Aboriginal and Islander. So that's the first thing. But I guess going back to the question just before that about the, the
definition.
The definitions, like, they're quite clumsy. Mm. But I don't know what else we've got, because the other system is what the Canadians have, and they actually have, they're almost like driver's license, and they have expiry dates on it. So
they have C51.
Wow.
They talk about blood quantum in Canada.
Well, this is it.
You know, you can be, you've got one white parent, you're under a policy of C51. You lose status rights. If that's what getting a treaty does, then I don't want a treaty. Yeah. So we're actually in front in many ways. You're right. Mm. What's the answer?
But for Aboriginal women in Canada, this is the most appalling. They see it as a form of genocide. So if an Aboriginal woman marries a white man, she no longer has status. Mm. But if a white woman marries an Aboriginal man, she has status. And status means you can go to the medical service and get, free clinics and various other things. And they're having major discussions about status and non-status because an Aboriginal woman who gives birth to a child is giving birth to an Aboriginal child. Mm. How does that make you feel as a mother if you were in that situation?
Extremely uncomfortable. I mean, I guess to add to the conversation, I'm also on a board in which we have to consider that issue. And we're very careful about the conversation we have with people if we cannot confirm it. And the conversation is about, we're not saying that you're not Aboriginal. We're just saying we don't have the capacity to be able to to sign off on it. And there are three criteria. It's not enough just to be of descent. It is about identification. It is about community involvement. So there are times where we have to say to people, maybe you go back to the community that you identify with, that where you are known, or where somebody knows you, or knows your family, or knows your auntie, or where there's some connection there. And I think that community connectedness, I think that's an important criteria to have, that it's not just I suddenly discovered I've got an Aboriginal great-great-grandparent. Identity is lived.
You know, it's interesting. Yes. There was an article not long ago on that very issue. A gentleman who was clearly Aboriginal had been taken away and grown up in Melbourne with a white family. He had his own family and he wanted to get a confirmation. So he went to the local land council of the area he was living in. And of course, they were faced with this situation going, we're really sorry, we don't know you. You need to go back to the community where you come from or the country you come from, because we don't legally feel we can sign this. And of course, it hit the front pages going, and of course, it was an urban organisation. Big discussions about the many people who are in that organisation that were regarded as fair-skinned. And but the way it was reported made out that we were denying this man his Aboriginality, which was not we, but they. But the reality was they were simply saying, you need to go where people know you. We don't have the right to sign this. So the issue of confirmation is a big one, but it brings in the whole thing of identity. And lately we're seeing discussions on who is an Aboriginal? How far back do you go? How many generations is it? You know, you've got a great-great-grandmother that happened to be Aboriginal. Or is it a lived life? And I'd love to hear your views on that, because that whole discussion in the community is changing, not only from whether you do have this ancestry, to the point of where you're living and where your country is.
I totally subscribe to what you're saying, this idea about it being a lived thing, because those three questions are trying to quantify, so they can take a picture and see what it looks like. But I think what we're all doing, the four of us, is we have this heritage, but we're applying it in our domains of expertise, and mine's in architecture and health and writing and art. And it's like, you know, when you try to look at the moon, you look beside it to see it. That's how I think we could probably, you know, start thinking about identity, just in a slightly different thing. It's a verb, not a noun. That's the conversations I have with my peers.
How do you introduce yourself when you meet people? Do you are you an architect? Are you Kevin first, or are you your language group person first? Or
the best way I can describe it, there was an old Taoiseach called Charles Haughey in Ireland, and he had the gift of the gab, and he turned up to all the different counties, and he'd start a speech by saying, "It's great to be home." And he was what he needed to be in that context, in that conversation. He was also a nudist.
Was he nude at the time?
So it depends, because identities, you know, it's a whole kind of, to me it's a daisy chain of things. So if I'm with a group of architects, I identify as an architect. My degree says I'm an architect. They tell me I'm an Indigenous one. If I'm at the football, I'm a Red supporter. If I'm, you know, at the school, I'm doing these other things, and, you know, so on and so forth. So it depends what the context is.
I mean, I think none of us here want to act as the moral compass what it means to be Indigenous, Aboriginal, Torres Strait Islander. I'm really interested in whose agenda we're serving by policing identity. Mm. And so if you look throughout our history, the colonial imperative has been to deny our existence. So, you know, Terra Nullius and invasion was premised on the idea that we weren't even human. When it was discovered that we were human, we were a race without a future, so we were a dying race. So we were able to, you know, there was protection and segregation and rounding up of us Melbourne missions and reserves. When it was discovered that our population was growing in size, new theories had to emerge to explain away our existence in this country. And this whole idea that we are not really Aboriginal serves that agenda. And so I'm really reluctant to try and assert a position that Aboriginality has to equal this or that, or it can't be this or it can't be that, because we all have a different encounters with colonisation. We have different stories, different journeys, and I'm really interested in how we put forward our stories of identity as authentic just because they're our stories, rather than subscribing to colonialist imaginings of the noble savage or those kinds of ideas. And I think we have to question what we're doing when we are policing each other's identity, and whose interests are we serving?
Yeah, and that whole policing has been going on very recently.
Absolutely. Like, there's so many things I wanted to pick up with Kevin as well, but there's so many things that many of you would have watched the Mundine Gill fight recently. I didn't watch it. I was doing Twitter and watching the live feed that they had there, and I nearly felt ill with the stuff that I was reading from our mob about Gill. And, you know, my response the next day was just one or two lines saying, because somebody asked me in a public forum, I wonder what Anita Heiss thinks about this. And I just said, I think we're all just better. I don't want to be the identity police. I think people should focus on how they carry themselves out every day as individuals and not be concerned about how other people identify themselves. One of the reasons I wrote product placement, Am I Black Enough for You, was to actually show that through everyday life and activity, whether it's working with the kids at LAPA or shopping at Tiffany's, my Aboriginality is part of every day. Mm. And as I said, it's not something I sit around and talk about or wake up thinking about, or, you know, I just get on and I get myself to work and I do my thing, and I know that the conversations I have, and the invitations I get are often because I'm Indigenous, and that's because I can say the things that need to be said without knifing somebody. You know, I'm 40 now and I cannot say what I read on Twitter. I wouldn't say now what I was watching 20-year-olds say on Twitter, because I could see in them the passion of youth that I had when I was young, and then with wisdom and age and hanging around with elders more, you learn if anyone's got the right to be cranky about a lot of things, it's our old people. And they're not the cranky ones that are saying all the stuff. Mm. It's our generation. We're cranky because we know how old people were treated. You know, and I've just gone through that hideous court case because, and the reason I went in there, and I know we didn't want to talk about it, the reason I went in there is because I refuse to have Australian media tell me who I am. And I refuse to have them intimidate young Indigenous Australians by suggesting to them that if they live in the city, that if they go to a Catholic school, that if they have blue eyes or they're light skin, if they don't have substance abuse issues, if they're not on welfare, if they want to be an architect, then they can't be black. Mm-hmm. I mean, we had a civil rights movement in this country that's still going on that was about us having all those opportunities. And the minute we start to evolve and change out of that stereotype, you can't be black anymore. You must be coming white. And
it's that we have a new middle class.
Mm. And why shouldn't we? Everyone absolutely. I know works 70 hours a week. Mm. They work hard and they sit on boards and they do love jobs, volunteering. You know, why shouldn't we?
I think that's
we?
What you're saying.
I mean, as a mum...
The fear of there's this whole new middle class who are educated, bright, articulate, they've actually gone through the system, understand the system, are actually working in the system and have the capacity to change the system from an Aboriginal perspective.
Yeah. I mean, as a mum, I find it really horrific, some of the stuff that's said about the possibilities of our existence as Aboriginal people, because I want my kids to do the best they can at school, do whatever they want. And I was always raised that my Aboriginality was never a barrier to me achieving. It was the thing that motivated me to be 10 times better than the person beside me, because we had to be. There's an African-American scholar, Williams, who talks about racial socialisation. And he says it's a task that black parents have in raising healthy black kids with a healthy sense of identity in a world that demonises that blackness. Mm. And for many Indigenous families and individuals, we are constantly negotiating having a healthy, strong sense of self in a world that sees it as problematic and uncertain and constantly questioning it.
Can I also can I just say that, you know, when I was a little kid and Paul Keating was the Prime Minister of Australia, And you could turn the TV on a Saturday, and Yothu Yindi is playing on the TV. You turn the radio on, and Wurrumpi Band's on, and it's mainstream, and it was cool. There was no shame growing up as Aboriginal person. Like, and by the time I became a teenager, and then Howard became Prime Minister, and then all of these questions started coming around, and I was also having an identity crisis, as all teenagers do, I was really confused about, you know, sort of what you were saying. Like, I thought, well, no, everyone in my family has a job. We all go to school. Like, these are just the things we do. We do these things that are different on the weekends, you know, but it's kind of normal too. Like, it's not that different. And I think that really took us back, you know, a long way with the Howard years, in terms, because we're really on a good streak. Like,
well,
I
after that Redfern speech,
but, you know,
we committed the
murders.
There
was no shame.
We took the children, and then we got Johnny. And on that note, let's have some questions. I put Johnny in there as a bit of a ironic. You black fellas know what I mean. Does anyone have any questions? We'd love to open up the floor. There are roving mics on either side. And we'd like a question, not a testimonial.
While we're waiting, can I just talk about language, the language of Paul Keating's empowering, assuming responsibility to the, and then the shift in language that happened when we had the Howard era, and even, who have we got now? Oh, good job, Gardner, but you know, the Tony Abbott sort of situation.
Yeah.
Now, there's a whole, I hope you're thinking of questions now because I'm nearly finished. There's a whole range of language that Westerners use for Indigenous peoples in Canada and the US and the worldwide, around the world, that they don't use for themselves. Can we do a really quick exercise? Can the non-Indigenous people in the room who identify as Australian hold their hand up? Yep. Can you leave your hand up, thank you, if you have some mixed heritage, English, Irish, Chinese, Japanese? So nearly 100% of the 80% of the room, thank you. Would it be fair to say then that you all have one identity, that of Australian, and you have mixed heritage? Well, so do we. I have one identity, and obviously my wonderful late father was Austrian, but my entire socialisation process throughout life and living in Australia was that as an Aboriginal girl, well, an Abbo, Born Coon, Chocolate Drop and Cocoa Pop when I was at school, but we have one identity with many heritages which we all embrace and are proud of. But I never hear white Australians say I'm half caste or I'm part Aboriginal because my grandparents were born in Scotland. 53 or 56% of Australians have at least one parent born overseas. Westerners talk about becoming cosmopolitan and multicultural and having development. We're told we're watering down our bloodlines, we're straddling two worlds, we're losing our culture, we're becoming urbanised. You know, we're told you're half caught. And don't kid yourself that language doesn't still exist, because it does. And Queensland's very bad. I say that from New South Wales. But so there's a whole language matters and leadership matters. And that's what happened. There was a shift in language, and which then shifts the psyche of a nation. So we go from Paul Keating's empowering speech. We had Kevin Rudd's very empowering speech for the apology. And we have a whole new language now. At the age of 41 or however old I was, for the first time in my life, I read in the newspaper that I'm a light-skinned Aborigine, that I'm a white Aborigine. I was always the brown kid at school. And now I'll be interested to see when the next version of the Macquarie Dictionary comes out, whether or not we joke about it, but it's used so much now in all the debate outside of our circles about who we are, that light-skinned white Aboriginal, political Aboriginal. I might be surprised if that appears in the dictionary.
Well, I'm a half caste with a chip on my shoulder, but I say, don't worry, I'm working on the shoulder pads. Are there any questions? You're kidding me. Thank you.
Hello. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Davey Thompson, and my grandfather is Bidjara and Inungai Mob from Central West Queensland. And my grandmother's people are Waka Waka Gubbi Gubbi, they're my father's parents. And my mum's from the really, really big Miglu tribe.
Cute.
I have to ask, I lived out in Barcaldine for a long time, which is Central West Queensland. And for a long time, I wasn't really exposed to all this black politics. It wasn't until really I came to the city that it really, really, really showed. And, you know, I'm not really a bush black or anything like that. I just really need to ask a panel of experts, I guess. My Aboriginality in recent years has been questioned by both black and white. And I just really need to know, what is harder for you guys to deal with? The black fellas questioning your Aboriginality or the white fellas?
Mm. Oh, look, for me, the deepest insult that an Aboriginal person can do to another Aboriginal person is to question it, yeah. You know. And there's a whole lot of names that I'm not going to mention here that are used. And we talk about lateral violence, and I think that that's a real issue. Mm. I have to say, in my experience, my identity has been most problematic for non-Indigenous people, though. Mm. Yeah. They've been most troubled by my claim to my Aboriginality. Yeah, I think it's harder in our community when we do cop it, because it just rips at our soul that our own community would do that to us, knowing how powerfully oppressive that has been for our people throughout our history. But my skin colour has been less problematic for my own community than it has for the wider community.
Yeah.
So I get people are, you know, I'm sort of, my ethnicity is a bit ambiguous. So taxi drivers or hairdressers or strangers will say, so, you know, where are you from? And when I say, I sort of sometimes I play with them and say Australia and just keep saying that. But when I say Aboriginal, there's this whole discussion about how I couldn't possibly be Aboriginal.
Which is so beautiful for an Aboriginal.
Yeah, they and articulate
so nicely.
So they know that I'm different, but they can't accept that I'm Aboriginal.
Yes.
Mm. And I think that's, so I'm not sure I answered your question.
But one of the big things is, of course, if we were to go around the room and ask the black fellas in this room, one of the things that does help us when we're discussing, we're not discussing colour, because that's, we're colourblind, we're discussing kinship. We know a lot of other people's families, and so we immediately know, okay, Wiradjuri, my goodness, I know immediately what your country like Paul loves out there on the flat plains.
They're so jealous, don't be so jealous.
Not Bundjalung with our gorgeous rainforest. But it gives us that sense too that we know where your country is, or we can feel who you are.
It's like an Aboriginal passport.
Yeah. Is there any more questions? Yes, a gentleman just on the... And the microphone's coming over to you. Thank you.
Oh, hi, I'm Shane. A number of years ago, I was working on an Aboriginal community in Northern Territory. And one of the maintenance guys there, Anglo, white Australian guy, he... I'm a little sketchy on the details, it was a while ago, but he was actually invited to some kind of initiation ceremony with the Indigenous community. And I just wondered how that sort of fits into this debate, where obviously he didn't have the Aboriginal heritage, but I guess to be invited to an initiation ceremony, he must have gained some sort of level in the community.
I know the right person who's actually sitting in the audience, and if you wouldn't mind, brother, someone who spent a lot of time in some communities where those sorts of ceremonies occur. John, would you mind just answering that whole thing about kinship and adoption into the community for this gentleman? Did you hear
not
the question?
Not to put you on the spot there.
Nothing like putting you on the spot. Hey, but he's a Bundjalung man.
Oh, here we go.
Many people are... Is that working?
Yep. Yeah.
Many people are invited to either... There's two things. You can actually be invited to witness things. To take part in something is something else. And to take part in something means you have a commitment and a responsibility then to engage with that community and that family. Most of the people I know who go and witness things, many people do, and that's a privilege. It's a very not a privilege, it's a very important thing to happen, and it's very strongly enlightening and revelatory to see those things. To actually take part means a commitment, and I've never seen the people who sometimes take part in a very peripheral way, actually really bond to be responsible. Like, I can't see any of the men that I saw take part in a peripheral way. They're not going to give their daughters in marriage to somebody else. I can see that in an arranged marriage. So it's a nice gesture on the part of the people there. It's not, it's a compliment, but that's how I would just think it is. It doesn't say you're Aboriginal. It fits you into a system. Everything has to fit into a system, into a social system. And that social system is actually part of a world view system, rather than just being about whether I'm related to you or me or whatever I'm actually fit into. It's a part of a mnemonic device, a system that allows you to think about the world in a different way. Now, you could talk about this forever and a day, but anyway, but that's my reaction to it. So I have seen, I have gone to taking part in religious rituals, but other non-Aboriginal people have also been to those rituals. Not all of them are actually taken part. So I understand what is being offered, but very few people actually really engage. Does that make sense?
It does. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and it does. So, if you want to really engage, well, that's another thing. It doesn't make you Aboriginal, though. it just means that you're fitted into that world. Just remember that Indonesian people were coming here well before Captain Cook, hundreds of years before Captain Cook. And they were incorporated into the Aboriginal world in Australia, but that didn't make them Aboriginal. Mm-hmm. It just means they're incorporated into the world view of Aboriginal people. Does that make sense?
Richard Bell recently claimed that perhaps people could go and live with a community for 2 years and then they could be Aboriginal. And Gary Foley seemed to agree with him.
Richard, are you in the room? Because you were before.
Mightn't work if they went out to La Perouse. I don't know much about that, but it also, it's relevant for that particular place. So it'd be pointless going to Wagga and say, well, I've done ceremony in Santa Teresa or Mirujulu. Would that be fair to say that it's for that, whatever privilege they've had is relevant for that place? Yeah, would that be fair to say?
It means for that
family. Community, that you're yeah. those people there. Family, yeah.
But as I said, it doesn't make you Aboriginal.
No.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
what
yeah,
I've said.
Yeah.
We have another question.
Thanks.
Thank you.
My name's Claire, and I'm just after some advice from the panel, really. I'm a non-Indigenous person and I'm raising two beautiful Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander children. And I'm a sook, so I'll try not to cry. And their dad lives in Cairns, so they're separated from their family. And I'm just after some advice, sorry I am a sook, about how I can raise them to be strong Black children and strong in their identities.
Do they have contact with their family back in Cairns?
Yeah, they do.
There's a big Torres Strait Islander and Aboriginal community in Brisbane. And particularly a lot of our old people are incredibly generous, not only with their time, but their knowledge. And there's lots of organisations, you know, across the region. And I would suggest maybe contacting one of those organisations as well, so they have contact with other community members. Are they young children?
Yeah, they're 4 and 6.
Mm. Oh.
I think as Chelsea was saying, identity is really about connection and and not commitment necessarily, because it's about action within community. So it's just really about participation and being part of and belonging. Like, to me, community is about a belonging, whatever the community's architects or writers or whatever. So I think it's really, you know, about engaging with the
community. It's hard for them when they don't have that agency because they're so young and
yeah,
it's dependent on
babies,
me.
Yeah.
And you love them, very clearly love them.
Oh, I love them to death. And I've got connection with the community in Cairns too, but I'm not a Brisbane person and I don't have connection down here, and I'm just endlessly worried about what that's going to mean for their identity and for them when they're growing up, and I try my absolute best, but it's just not the same, I guess.
But I think you're well on the way. Like, as a now I can't advise you as a mother, but as a child when I was growing up in Brisbane, I do remember my mother being very isolated with our small family, but she made sure we went home. and that was enough to keep the gate open. So every time I go home to the mission, we'd fight, I'd come back, and this tap happened. This like year in, year out. By the time 15, boys, well, we're kind of good mates now. And then now we're inseparable. So it's contact. Yeah. But I mean, I think if the kids have a mother who is aware of this matter, like, they're incredibly lucky kids. So.
Yeah. And can I just say, as an Indigenous mum, I share your same fear. Because of what, you know, we are a minority, and how do I raise my kids with a strong sense of identity and all that kind of stuff. We lived in Brisbane. My family are in North Queensland and down Tweed Heads. So we were the one family in our family that were on our own in a, you know, predominantly white neighbourhood. It was my white mother that took us to NAIDOC Week every year as kids, you know. So you have a role to play, and it's a journey of exploring different options and ways to engage, and anything you do is something. And encouraging our children to think critically about what they're hearing about themselves and empowering them to be strong and who they are and be authentic to their own story, I think is really important.
Great advice.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm just behind the gentleman at the back.
And while the microphone's going there, just to plug...
With the beard and the scarf.
Plug my industry. Magabala Books does the most beautiful children's books in Australia. And so you could, you know, Kooral Dargon at the State Library, best library in the country. You know, I would be saying...
You're making a few bests here.
No, it is. I'm moving here because it is the best library in the country. And Magabala does do beautiful children's books by Indigenous authors and illustrators. And so story time, the young kids, I'd be saying, read them some beautiful stories from around the country, but... You know.
And there's a great lot of writers in Brisbane who do Black Ink children's stories.
Yep, there you go.
You can get them online.
Yep.
Yes.
In the media in the past few days, we've had the comment again about being better educated for Murray kids to be in boarding schools. Could we have some comment on that, please?
I could probably start on that one. I've been doing a lot of work with... a very divisive character in our community, a guy called Noel Pearson, for many years. Him and I and a number of other guys went through private schools here in Brisbane. And I completely support that endeavour. There's a manner in which I think it should happen, which probably is where the difference lies. But I just believe in the same way Malcolm X was stating it, that education is the key to everything, and you should aspire to get yourself in front of the best system. So... that happens to be a private school, so be it.
We're working with a group of some close to 50 boys from the Nudgee College who are going to be part of our opening ceremony tomorrow evening at 6:30. It's free out there. You would have seen the sand circle out on the cultural forecourt. Astounding. The boys are all boarding at Nudgee. The most amazing, cultural, inspirational young men I've met for a long time. It gives me great hope for the future.
And some of them are Wiradjuri, I found out
and
today.
Yeah, they're Wiradjuri, there's a couple of
Bundjalung
in there.
They can dance.
They're from Bamaga,
seriously?
Cape York, Lockhart River. And then there's about 10 of them. I go, where's your family from, darling? What's your mum's name? Because we go, what's your mum? Oh, we know your auntie, sisters, brothers, you know, cousin. And they go, oh no, we're only like two blocks away from Nudgee. All right. Then I realise this place provides them with this community, but also they're in a safe environment, they've got study opportunities, they go home all the time, they all go home a lot. But there's an extraordinary woman I met last night, and if we could have and actually clone her and put her right across the country, she's looking at ways of connecting families who send their kids to boarding school from an Aboriginal perspective, then connecting back to the community. So the community can ring the school anytime and there is this exchange and crossover. But as Kevin says, education is the key. It's changing our lives.
I think it's got to happen in the way you described it. And this is where it gets interesting, because the minute you isolate a child, take away the support mechanisms and start treating education as a solo endeavour, that to me is the problem, because there's the learning that happens during the day when you're in class, then there's the learning that happens afterwards as a father reading to your daughters and the children and all that other stuff in between. Like, so the education process is 24 hours, and it's in the family as well. So
I think in the conversation it's really important to focus on the fact that it's a two-way exchange. It's not just poor Black kids getting going to an elite private school. The school and the school community has much to benefit from having our kids coming into those spaces. And so it's not just about the kids having to leave their identity at the door and then come to the school and conform and just be like the rest of, you know, all the other kids. But we need to have the conversation with these schools about how they're learning about us and through our kids and our families and our community. And, you know, we talk about reciprocity all the time, but to me it's about that two-way knowledge exchange. It's not just us getting a free ride.
And it I think you'll see the success in retention rates when schools are prepared and have those support mechanisms, because I've spoken to teachers at professional development days and with schools with cash who want to have borders and so forth, but have no mechanisms in place to deal with the student outside of the classroom, or even inside of the classroom if the student's not used to wearing shoes to school, and like simple things like that. But they desperately want to be doing something to help generate a new future of educated young Indigenous people. But it is about the schools being prepared for the task involved. It's not just getting the kids' uniforms and putting them in the classroom. It's much bigger than that.
And teachers are bigger than that. Most teachers are. Mm. Look, just quickly, my girl goes to Winona in North Sydney. I couldn't get an Aboriginal scholarship to go there because guess what? I don't live in a remote community because I'm not one of those real ones. So I managed to get a rural scholarship to get her there.
Hey.
Since we've been there, the school has opened their arms. They've never met a black fella in their lives. And of course, she's really fair with blue eyes. And so now we have 5 scholarships where she's actually raised the money as a year 12 student. And there are girls coming from across the country for that. And it's brilliant. So teachers are expanding. There's a question up the back there. Sorry, I just had to put that in because I think it's great.
There was one over there.
As a non-Indigenous man, I can understand why it's critical for any community, particularly perhaps Indigenous people, to have a ability and that clear sense of identity and who you belong to, if that's important to you. But I wonder in some senses in the broader community if perhaps it's been given too much importance outside of Indigenous communities. When I am looking for the services of a barrister or a ophthalmic surgeon or an international tax advisor, I don't care if he identifies as Scottish and plays his bagpipes on the weekend. It's who he is and what he can do as a person and a professional. Outside of the Indigenous communities, I'm wondering if there's too much weight perhaps on the tests and the money and the grants and the ways of judging externally whether someone is or should be regarded as a member of the Indigenous community. Do you think perhaps we put too much weight on that outside of the Indigenous communities in the broader culture?
I think that we choose to identify because of what you said so pertinently last night. When you understand all of the things that your family couldn't have because of discrimination and the history of this country, it is like your duty when you now have these, you have access to education and resources, and you know, it's your duty to do the best you can, and identifying publicly is part of that process because you are remembering them. So it is important. It doesn't take away from the task or your capacity to be a professional. I just, you know.
I think I understand the question. And I just want to go back to the use of language, and that is, we still don't, we are visible in the newspapers nearly every day, most of it not good, right? When we talk about who is Australian, who's not Australian, another ridiculous debate, that they're un-Australian. We talk about, people talk about the Greek community, Vietnamese community and so forth, and then we'll hear, and real Australians who are Anglo-Australians and so forth. We are one of the few in countries with Indigenous peoples where we don't talk about our First Nations peoples. Because nobody celebrates coming second. So if we have to forge our identity in a way that makes... I mean, this discussion's only become so big in the last few years because non-Indigenous Australia made it big, right? They made it big because they had a problem with who we were because we didn't fit the stereotype. But it's interesting to me that we don't use the language that other countries use. Everyone embraces Cathy Freeman when she wins gold. She's Australian. Blackfella steals a car, they're a blackfella. Right? We're only owned when white fellas want to own us. So we're now, we're playing the game our way. You know, this is, you know, we don't control the media. Everything you see is not controlled by us. Everything you see when you go to the surgeries and government legislation, everything, we're not controlling that. That's all being done for us, and we just get to up and go to work every day and then have these conversations occasionally to help other people understand.
So strap on your seatbelts, because it's going to be an incredible ride into the future. We've got room for two more questions, this gentleman here and then one over there, and then we're going to have to wrap up. But as I said, we are going out to the foyer. We have some drinks, and you can come and talk to our panellists out there. Thank you, brother.
Yama, my name is Bo Smiron. My father is from northern New South Wales,
a small town
called Moree, from the mission there. My mother, her name is Nerida Skewthorpe, from Mount Garuga on a reserve. She was born. What I wanted to ask is, what is a middle-class Aboriginal? And with that name tag, will that create segregation within our own communities, just like half-caste, full-blood, and quarter-caste?
Good question.
Can I just say, I really loathe the term middle-class Aboriginal. There was a study, I think, done in the 90s by the Centre for Aboriginal Economic Policy Research, and they looked at Aboriginal income and versus the mainstream. And we genuinely know that the higher income you get, the better outcomes you have in a whole range of indicators, and of education and housing and all this kind of stuff, and health. But for Indigenous people, there wasn't the same shift upwards with income. So to just think about Aboriginal people solely in terms of fortnightly wage actually doesn't do justice to the experience of being an Indigenous person. And so even if you may be middle class and may have a job and have a regular wage coming in, you're still supporting your family, you're still taking people into your home, you don't stop being Aboriginal just because you're in a higher income bracket. And the statistics show us that Aboriginal people don't see the same benefits with the increase in income that the general population do. And that tells us a story about the experience of Aboriginal people.
It certainly does. They obviously don't work in the arts.
They're not writers who earn $11,000 a year.
Yeah, that's right.
No, the whole bourgeois black thing, love that term. Everybody that I know that's gone through university and wherever they're working in government, or they're not writers or anyone like in our field, but they're all actually responsible for looking after their family, and you're there. So they may be earning an income, but it's actually going across an entire family. And they're also the ones that are chairing boards and then are sitting in organisations, and you know, they may be working high rank policy or whatever they're doing, but they're also doing a whole lot of other things. And so I think we feel, when we see our people in despair, we feel in it in our heart. And we see, when we see our people doing well, we put them down. I just go, I don't get
that. The tall poppy syndrome in the Aboriginal communities is very alive and well, and that is another discussion, and it is something we should really consider. We've got room for one more question.
Very quickly, greetings from the Torres Strait. My name's Kane Atwano. I'm a Miriam man from the Dawareb tribe, and I'm with a Yorta Yorta woman, my life partner. She's also the niece of the famous Sapphires.
Oh, everyone!
She doesn't sing.
sister, that was the next question.
Can you sing?
Her mum is the big sister of those Sapphire girls. But anyway, we're having to get
free. He's right. We clocked you now.
I've got to cover.
It's very right, the family tree.
Now, very quickly, can I just say, I work with young people. I work with a whole range of young people in schools. We are now getting a whole generation of young people, like sister said here, with your children. We are getting children who, through family, are identifying, oh, we've got some Aboriginal. And they're saying, yep, when there's time for leadership camps, they want to be part of it. And I work with kids who come in with this distorted view of the world in terms of who they are. Mm-hmm. We are getting, and this is across the country, we're getting young people now who, I grew up in the 70s and 60s, was a fear generation. Black fellas were living in fear. My parents lived in fear. We were frightened of government. Government come and take us. Now, these kids are being told, hey, you know, got a prime minister saying sorry globally. So we're now empowering these young people. So what, and it leads on to the question from my sister here, in terms of how do we cope with this new generational change? It's no good talking about, you know, now. We've got to look for the next 20, 50 years and where we're going as a community and a culture.
Thank you. Well, look, could we please applaud our extraordinary panel. I've been given the wrap-up. Was there one last question over here? Okay, can we just do this one last? There you go, sis.
My name's Kayla Tyson. I'm a Maruni woman of the Gurang Nation, and I have ties to the Noongar people of the Quandamooka region. Speaking on what Kainat said, there is a new generation, and mine's not a question, but more of a challenge to everyone. The young Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander people in the room, not even young, because I know that, you know, not everybody knows where they came from, whether you're young, old or whatever. But we're at a time, in a time where we can get on the internet in 1 second and learn a lot of things. It may not always be right what's written up on there, especially on Wikipedia, but there's no excuse for us. There's no excuse for us not to know things. Like, there's no excuse for us to be ignorant. We have these events that are on, and yeah, it's not going to give us all the answers that we need, but it's triggering questions in our mind where we can then go and find the answers for that. And my challenge to our people is that it's our time to empower ourselves. Don't stand there and wait for the government to put our language and our education into the schools. Find it yourself and then teach someone else. Mm. And for the non-Aboriginal people in the room, it's just about breaking down that stereotype. Like they were saying, like, can all my girls stand up, please, in this line? Just stand up for 1 second, Becky. Anyone. Stand up.
They're beautiful girls.
Look at my girls.
Yeah.
We all work, we're all beautiful, and we're all Aboriginal. We all look different. Mm. And yes, we might go out and drink and dance and party and everything on the weekend, just like your kids do. Mm. We're no different. So just think about that.
Wow. On that wonderful, spirited note, thank you for the respect, darling. Thank you. Our future indeed is bright. We do know who we are. We all live on an incredibly ancient land, but the beauty you folks have in this room, we have knowledge keepers who come from the oldest living adapting race on the entire planet. No one else has got it. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you to our panel.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm going to cry. Thank you.